Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the Kansas City Downtown Marriott, Kansas City's meeting place, by Fred and Lou Hartwig, the support of the William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank trustee, and by the bequest of the late Virginia Childers of Belton, Missouri.
Welcome to Ruckus, that weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. Our thanks to those of you who pledged $100 last week to support the Ruckus program. The Ruckettes will see you Thursday evening, November the 10th at Californo's in Westport. It has seemed likely for the last year or so that sooner or later, and likely sooner than later, Kansas City government would have to deal with flash mobs and other large gatherings of teens on the Country Club Plaza. Then last weekend, with Mayor Sly James and other black community leaders walking the plaza trying to assess the problem, gunshots erupted, three teens were struck by the bullets, James was pushed to the ground by his security team, police and helicopters on horseback and motorcycles, on foot and in cars, moved in and tried to manage the melee. Mayor and council are trying to find ways to stop the problem. What are some of the options, Gwen?
Well, the number one option that they're considering today is to continue the existing curfew for youth 16 and above. That is midnight on the weekends and 10 or 11 o'clock on weekdays. But to extend the curfew for young people 15 and under to 9 o'clock on weekends. And the change here, more importantly to talk about this, I think is what was a good idea. Rather than having a citywide curfew, which was the mayor's initial recommendation, Councilman John Sharp came with this alternative, which makes better sense. It focuses on the entertainment districts, the plaza, the power and light district, Westport, with one flaw, I think. It should also include the 18th and Vine Historic District because it is an entertainment district and it is east of Truce, which adds a little bit more equity in this process. The other piece of it is that it brings forward immediate action to address a problem that needs to be addressed immediately. It needs to be enforced equitably, and it gets to the root of the initial problem. Now, the other piece that's important about this is, what do you do when you pick up all these kids? And so they're coming with the recommendation probably to have community organizations supported with establishing some curfew centers. But one thing that I think needs to happen here, number one, you have to recognize that a curfew at this point is a Band-Aid approach. It's not solving the problem. It's just dealing with the symptoms
of the problem. What is the problem?
Well, there are a number of problems. One is parental responsibility. And the way you address the parental responsibility issue for parents who leave their children under age 16, who allow the plaza or any other institution to be the babysitter, there is a serious problem. So in this curfew ordinance, there should be stiffer penalties for that. One would be that if we pick up your child and your child is under the age of 16, just as we issue a citation for a drunk driver with their first offense, or you have a traffic violation, you pay a stiff fine and you also go to school. Parents who should be required to pay a fine and participate in parent education classes.
You know, Gwen, though, there's the perception, and like the rest of you to join in, that this is a problem spawned by the black community.
Well,
it is not a problem that involves a lot of people from the white community. Is the problem centered in the black community of Kansas City, Missouri?
The problem in this is the outgrowth of benign neglect of the urban core.
Good phrase.
That's what it is. And so we continue to not address development in the core to put to provide jobs, entertainment, other housing.
So this is society's fault.
When you neglect a community, we all have a responsibility. There's a government responsibility and a community responsibility to address what is happening in the core.
Yeah, you've been writing and blogging about this. Some of your thoughts about the plaza.
Well, I mean, Gwen said a number of them on the curfew. It's obviously not the only solution. They held a big meeting on this about 16 months ago, and the bottom line was youth said, gee, we'd like more stuff to do. You know, and that's probably true. I mean, there could be community centers that were open at night, things like that. That would get good kids to do, you know, to go there, and then, so you'd have you know, fewer people in the plaza and the hooligans would go down there, it'd be a lot easier to spot. I want to address Gwen's question about, you know, it's benign neglect and, you know, it's not the black community's fault, it's the white community's fault or, you know, whatever, it's all society's fault. Partly that's true. I mean, that is partly true. I mean, I'm sorry the conservatives won't like to hear that, but that's partly true. But the liberals won't like to hear that, yeah, some of these problems have been around for so long that the black community could have dealt with some of these things in a lot of places. We've had black mayors, we've had black council members, we've had black elected officials, well, we've had black community leaders like Gwen. Some of the solutions that we could have done?
Let me tell the producer, we're going to run long on this, so you'll have to make up the time somewhere else, because I think this is intriguing and we just barely got started. Woody, we're getting text at the radio station and it's being reported elsewhere, and I suspect it's true to some extent that businesses are looking hard at this situation on the plaza and some are planning to not renew their leases.
Well, I think that will go away if you do something about it. Look, the plaza is one of the biggest, if not the biggest, asset the city of Kansas City, Missouri has. If they let it go, I can't tell you how disastrous that is. And you got to understand how close people are to making the nut on the business every month. If you take all the white suburbanites off the plaza on Friday and Saturday nights after dark, a whole bunch of restaurants, and there are a lot of restaurants on the plaza and bars, are going to not be making enough money to want to renew their lease. So you have to deal with this and stop it fast.
Mary.
Yes. Well, I think the two things I think I would like to add to Gwen's excellent review of the question. The police were a little lackadaisical here. I don't know, I've not heard this expressed very much, but you agree with me? Mm-hmm. Way to go, Woody. why not an instant response to, you know, people don't get to walk down the middle of the street in groups. You know, where were the side, I was down the plaza at 7:30 last Saturday night, and the groups were beginning to form, looked fine to me. But then I went on to other things. But, you know, I want a swift and sure response to disorderly conduct.
Anywhere, though.
A group of people walking around or milling around, standing around. Sure they've committed a crime.
They haven't committed a crime.
And they're going to be, police are going to be accused of racial profiling if they go up to a large group of black kids.
Let me finish my thought on this. That's the way you get around letting things like this develop. And also, I want to hear from somebody about who the shooters were.
Who were
the shooters here?
Amen. I got another question.
Really?
Look, if everybody's going to be terrorized by the ACLU into doing nothing, let's just shut the place down. We can take a few lawsuits, hire the lawyers, fight
they
the lawsuits.
Be.
All right, we got
send the horse cops down through there and put them on the side.
Wrap this up just very quickly. Has Mayor James...
We're going to
wrap it up. I just quick go around the panel. Mayor James handling this properly, doing okay?
So far, yeah.
Well, I think he came, the citywide idea, I don't think was the best idea. John Sharp came with something that was.
But he's looking for options.
But he's been open to it.
Mary.
Yes.
So
face down in the Cheesecake Factory flower bed.
Right.
Did have an effect.
Face down in the cheesecake. What do you think the mayor's been doing so far?
Okay, look, he's got to move. They've got to move fast. They got to do something fast on the plaza. I know.
Might be more visible.
In a week, I'll answer that question better.
Former Penthouse magazine pet and one-time stripper, Tammy Chapman, says Missouri Lieutenant Governor Peter Kinder is not fit to hold political office. Her assessment comes primarily from a time in the mid-90s when she was an entertainer in a club and performed private dances for then-state Senator Kinder. Chapman claims Kinder was enamored of her and became aggressive during the dances and tried to pull her down to his groin. It should be noted that Kinder has never been married, denies the allegations, and says the story is bizarre. Apparently, Chapman went public after bumping into Kinder, not literally, earlier this year at the bar where she was working in St. Louis. Oh, and one more thing, Kinder is the presumptive GOP nominee for governor next year. He says this is just an effort by Democrats to derail his campaign. Is that a reasonable assumption, Woody?
Well, obviously this is, the story's put out by a guy who's a Democratic activist who ran for Congress one time. He farmed this story around 8 years ago when Kinder first ran for lieutenant governor. That doesn't alter the fact that if you're going to be in public office, it is just incredibly unwise to hang around in these places. all we know for sure is whatever, because it's a he said, she said, whatever Kinder admits, he admits that he frequented or went to these places. Well, you know, if you go to those places, you're going to be hanging around with people who will eventually come back to bite you. And that's bad judgment.
So to speak.
Even so to speak. And it's unintended. Just let it stand on its own. And that's what's happened. And so, and then in the Republican Party, we're talking about the political impact, in the Republican Party, there's a significant body of people in the Missouri Republican Party who, if you simply went into one of these places, that's enough for them. So it is going to have a political impact. I mean, this is a state that passed Senator Bartle's bill to that basically makes these places almost impossible to operate anymore in this state. So, it's going to have an impact on his campaign, and a significant one, even if she's lying about everything except that he went to the clubs.
Right, and he made an important point. He admitted that.
Yeah.
That is going to hurt him politically. End of the day, if he's the nominee, I don't think it matters that much,
well,
quite frankly.
You know why? You can't make ads out of it. If you're Nixon, you can't touch it. Uh-huh. You just got to leave it alone.
I mean, in other words, if the Republicans gloss it over and nominate him.
Does it seem odd to anyone that this relationship began in the mid-90s, apparently, and she finally comes forward and talks in 2011?
Well, I don't know.
The year before he's going to run for governor?
Peter Kinder, I mean, the thing, you know you're in trouble politically when you become the object of ridicule, and when you offer opportunities for your political, you know who your opponents are by who's trying to ridicule you at the moment. And the word bizarre just keeps coming up in relation to Peter Kinder over and over again. I don't know. Tammy doesn't seem like Tammy's interested in politics. She took this picture. I mean, he came in and offered to, apparently, I don't know, is this part of what he admitted to, Woody, that he wanted her to come live with him because now he has a wonderful condo and there are two bedrooms and she, unless she wanted to snuggle up. Now, Peter, you're in public office, maybe you just don't go making those kind of offers. There are just a lot of things. He gets to a point and then he admits to things.
Well, he waited a couple of days before he answered the story, and that was not good. But before we move on, Woody, are there other people wandering around saying they want to be the Republican nominee for governor of Missouri?
No, and you know, Nixon's looking pretty strong. Nobody's lining up to run against him. Not that I know of. And I think, A, Kinder will be the nominee. B, this story will have little to do with the outcome of that election.
That's
but
okay.
That does not alter the fact that it does, you know, it does do him damage. When people start using you as the punchline of a joke, it's not a good thing in politics.
And it does help Jay Nixon, who, by the way, is part Republican. So, anyway.
Yeah, well, apparently he's Senator, Senator Jolie Justice says he's her 10th favorite Republican.
There you go.
Okay. We want a Kinder gentler Missouri.
Okay. Yeah, he's a moderate.
East is east and west is west and never the twain shall meet. But Kipling never met Joe Reardon and Sly James. The mayors of the two Kansas cities are forming a bi-state innovation team to look for ways to capitalize on Google's decision to launch a high-speed internet project in KCK. Co-chairing the campaign will be former Kansas City, Kansas school superintendent Ray Daniels and the man who opposed James in the mayor's election, Mike Burke. Over the years, Mary, we've heard a lot of talk about metro cooperation, not competition. Is this the same song, second verse, or are we getting a new lyric?
Well, everything about this is new. And the most important thing that's new is the investment that Google is willing to make in our metro area. And the next thing that's new about it is this particular coming together of KCK and the city of Kansas City, Missouri at Rockhurst University. They had their big meeting sponsored by the Chamber and others last week. The point here is with this innovation team, Mike Burke is very happy to be doing this. This is one of the things he campaigned. You know, and cheers to the mayor of Kansas City giving Mike Burke two very important appointments in terms of his long-range goals. So what are they going to do with this stuff? Well, Mike and Ray Daniels, former superintendent over in Wyandotte, are not charged with any technical applications of Google to the local business scene. That's not what they're going to be doing with their committee. Their committee is to use this fortunate circumstance now to build economic development and partnerships between KCK and the city of Kansas City, Missouri. and they think that cooperation on a rail line might be possible. There are going to be a need for some kinds of tax credits to start in incubators for technological startups. As Mike put it the other day, it's easier to grow a Fortune 500 company than to steal one.
Where does Johnson County fit into this calculation?
Well, where do they?
Noticeably absent, I guess, from the meeting was Johnson County representatives.
That's right.
Well, I will not be a Debbie Downer today because Mary's the upbeat person. This is going to do something.
Yeah.
But after 27 years of watching these kind of things, you know, pop up, we're going to get along, we're going to cooperate, we're going to do things, I think it's logical for people to go, well, yeah, but really show us what you're going to, you know, come back and show us something that you've actually done. You mentioned the rail. There are all kinds of, you know, there's stormwater stuff they could work on. I mean, there are actual practical things that could be done. You know, they could have compacts on, we're going to, you know, buy all this stuff together and save some money for taxpayers. Those are all probably little but good things. And I like Mike's comment about how it's, you know, it'd be better to cooperate on entrepreneurship, and that might help bring a company here that would then grow. That's all great. But you mentioned Johnson County. Poor old Johnson County. I mean, I am so sick and tired of hearing Johnson County say, well, they got to get their act together over there before we do anything with Kansas City. Sure. Do you understand that, you know, they're in, people, Johnson Countyans live in Kansas City, Missouri area. And it is very important that Kansas City gets the act together. I agree with you. That's why I've been writing about it for 27 years. But they have gotten the act together in some stuff. And the mayors like Michael Bamel in Naxa and Carl Gerlach in Overland Park, and they need to get involved in some, Ed Eilert, need to stop being so negative about this stuff and at least be open to some of the cooperation. Not a, maybe they don't have to go to the meetings, they're just open.
Let's return to the plaza for just a second before we go. Not the first topic about the plaza, but the zoning change situation that has occurred.
Deal.
Somebody tell us what that is.
I know Mary's happy.
I'm happy.
The high tower has backed off, and they're not going to ask for Highwoods. I mean,
Highwoods. Backed off on the high tower.
That's
good. Thank you. Highwoods has backed off, and they're looking at what Valencia Place as an option now for the office complex.
So there won't be an election what to do about that zoning.
No. So it
issue
all worked
in the
out,
Country Club Plaza.
I think everybody's going to be happy.
A new office building, as Gwen said, everybody's going to be happy.
We may now have the big three in the race for the GOP presidential nomination. The Iowa straw poll has given momentum to the already high-powered Michelle Bachmann campaign. Texas Governor Rick Perry announced to no one's surprise that he was running. Mitt Romney continues to lead in the polling going on elsewhere, and Tim Pawlenty has dropped out. Of those three, Bachmann, Perry, and Romney, which one might be the most likely to attract moderate Democrats and independent voters in the general election? Yale of Oaxaca.
Oh, it's Michelle Bachmann without a doubt, right? Oh, no, that's not it. Rick Perry? No, I see. I guess it's going to be Mitt Romney. I mean, it will, you know, we're still a year away, which I always forecast, and that was 4 years ago, said the same thing, but if you look at it, at least right now, it appears that the independents are going to decide this election, as they often do. So right now, if you're a really conservative Republican, you've got to at least be a little bit worried about a Bachmann or Perry campaign, because that might, you know, look like they're going too far to the right, and, you know, you don't want to keep those independents there. Now, there have been a couple good columns by Republican and conservative writers recently saying the worst job Obama does, the farther to the right we can go. And I agree with that. I mean, I think that is absolutely true, that at some point, this country, especially the economy is down, is going to be looking for somebody who, you know, tosses off the simplistic platitudes that Bachmann and Perry and Romney to a degree do, and Obama does, I guess, as well. Oh, we're just going to get some more jobs. You know, we're going to get government regulation cut down. We're going to do all this kind of stuff. You know, they're not doing it. I mean, have you noticed that Obama has not been able to do it? But have you also noticed that the Republicans have not been able
no
to do
one's
it?
No one's trying. That's the problem, Yale. I mean, this is good for them. You know, just go out there and be as crazy as you want to be. I mean, something has got to jolt this president into getting off the dime and getting his package together and getting out
there. You go,
there.
Woody.
Well, I am angry about it. I know where Decorah, Iowa is, and I did, by the way, predicted to you some weeks ago that Michelle Bachmann would win Iowa, and I was right.
Oh, she beat Ron Paul by like 200 votes.
Hey,
please.
She beat all the rest of them, too. The president needs to have a practical immediate, bold package for job creation.
He's got a jobs plan. He says he's going to announce it early September.
Not a big enough one, Mike, and not one that's captured the imagination of this country and can get some Republican votes in the Congress. It's time that thing come forward, and if it doesn't come in the first week that the Congress is back, then I don't know what happens.
The question was about the Republican candidates and who could attract moderates and so on. First of all, if you looked at Barack Obama and said, we're trying to attract moderates and independents, had the single most left-wing voting record in the U.S. Senate, to the left of Teddy Kennedy, and what did he do? Did great with independents and moderate voters. So we tend to focus on issues when we ask a question like that. Now, let's look at these. Just look at the people. Michelle Bachmann is telegenic without being cute, and that's important for a woman. She is tough. She's intelligent. She's articulate. She's got a life story that is very powerful and that trumps the classic Democrat question, you don't care about the poor and the downtrodden. Yeah, what about those 23 foster kids? So there's Bachmann. Can she appeal? That's your ultimate question. The answer is I think she can. Mm-hmm. Perry, I don't know enough about yet. The one thing I've seen I liked, he used hyperbole against Bernanke and the Fed, and when they called him out for it, he just doubled down, and that's the right thing to do. Romney's the one guy, I don't see how he spreads his base much after all this time. You look at him on television, you have the opposite reaction. Well, he is inauthentic, to use a tired word. There's something about the guy.
Here may be the good news for Republicans. Karl Rove, who knows a bit about presidential campaigns, says it is not too late for others to get in to the race for the GOP nomination.
And
in fact, he said just yesterday, I believe it was, that he thinks Sarah Palin is making the moves that suggest to him that she might get in. She'd shake things up.
Well, you know,
she might nominate Romney.
The mess of the Republican efforts here, it just indicates what kind of trouble the country is in. If things were kind of moving along okay, we'd have the usual Republican, the next guy in line kind of thing, and the president, it'd all be very nice. But this indicates that there's sort of turmoil in the country. There's turmoil on the right wing of the Republican Party. And Rick Perry's, you kind of poo-pooed it there, Woody, his comments about
Ben Bernanke. It's a little bizarre to suggest that the chairman of the Federal Reserve is perhaps a traitor. As a Republican, he said, is perhaps engaged in treason.
He said it is near
treason.
Well, I used to say it was an impeachable offense to introduce a new entitlement bill. That's hyperbole, man.
Well, I think there are a lot of Republicans who, if that came from a Democrat, Republicans would be going crazy about that.
From Democrats about George Bush.
All right, now, yes, they did. The Republicans went crazy about it, and I was among them, and so were you, saying, how dare you say things like Bush lied, people died. All right, before we go here, one quick question. Obama's going on vacation. Is that a good decision or bad decision? No, yes or no?
Absolutely.
Everybody deserves a vacation.
Clear your mind, go on vacation, yes.
No. Dumbest PR move he can make.
Going on vacation.
Now it's time for Now it's time for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckettes say yay or nay to people and events of the news. We start, and we'll have to be fairly brief here. We'll have to start with Mary.
Last Friday, the First National Bank of Olathe failed and the doors closed. By Saturday morning, that bank, thanks to the federal government, had been sold. The assets transferred, the locks changed, and it reopened on Saturday morning with a new owner. Not one depositor lost a dime. And there was no commercial activity disrupted. Sheila Bair, the former head of the FDIC, said, how'd she put it? Our deposits are backed by the full faith and credit of the United States government. The FDIC's guarantee is absolute. That's an example. Not one dime lost, no commercial transactions disrupted, and that's the federal government at its best.
I like to toast the life of Samir Clark, who was gunned down in a senseless shooting two nights ago in North Kansas City. Samir was an Eagle Scout. He was a lifeguard at the YMCA. He taught urban youth how to swim. He was to leave Kansas City tomorrow, heading to pursue his undergraduate degree at Tennessee State University as a transfer student from Grandview University in Des Moines, Iowa.
Samir's life was taken away too soon within a senseless act. He was a great community activist, a young man who was a shining example of great parenting, and he will be missed by all.
I yield my time to Yale.
I yield my time to Mike.
All right, if they'll roll the teleprompter to where I'm going to read next, I'll just take advantage of that, okay. Although you would have had time to do something.
No, we love you, Mike.
Probably just as well that you did. As someone who appreciates clever phrases but never creates them, I toast David Brody of CBN. He reports that a public opinion strategy poll shows 52% of those who say they are part of the Tea Party are also quite religious. So Brody has named that significant faction the Tea-vangelicals. And that's Ruckus for this week. Remember, there is still time to join us at Californo's on November the 10th, when we'll be roasted and toasted. Only 25 tickets left, so be sure to go to kcpt.org to get yours today. And now on behalf of the Ruckettes and our producer, Sean Holmes, I'm Mike Shannon. Thanks very much for watching, and good night.
Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the Kansas City Downtown Marriott, Kansas City's meeting place, by Fred and Lou Hartwig, the support of the William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank trustee, and by the bequest of the late Virginia Childers of Belton, Missouri.